For today's speaker is Dr. Alexandra Sheremet, working in Observatoire de Paris in France. And the talk will be on quantum memory and generation of a single collective excitation. So before starting, let me briefly remind you like the rules of the seminar. If you have some questions, please raise the hands. Of course, you have an option to switch on the microphone, but just please be cautious not to interrupt the speaker just in the middle of the sentence. And you also have a chance to ask the questions after the talk. So Alexandra, please.
Okay, Maxime, thank you for introduction. I think I can make a break between two parts of my talk to have some questions in the middle. As Maxime told, I work at the Observatory of Paris at the moment, but I will present our results on quantum memory, which we obtained at Laboratoire Kassler-Bosel at Sorbonne University. So here is a map of the center of Paris, and in the photo you can see the campus of our university, which before was the University of Pierre and Marie Curie, and now it is a part of new organization, Sorbonne University, and it's located just in the center of the Paris, close to the Seine and in historical Latino quartier. And so our lab, it's just another side of this building, very close to the river. And I did a postdoc in an experimental group of Professor Julien Laurent. And there we have three experiments. So we work on generation of non-classical state of light. So it is the first experiment. Then we have a free space experiment where we can study quantum memory with in an atomic ensemble with high optical depths. And we also have a nanofiber lab where we can fabricate a nanofiber and trap atoms nearby and study light matter interactions. And in my talk, I will present you our results about two last experiments, so free quantum memory in free space experiment and quantum memory in nanofiber configurations. So my work is motivated by quantum network, which requires a coherent interference between photon and matter. And so in 2008, Kimball proposed idea how to possible to create a quantum internet, where we can transfer information with photons. And for this, we need to create quantum channels. And also we need to create a non-classical or single photon state of photons. And we can generate and process information in nodes. And for this, we can use solid state or atomic ensembles. And to create some interface between them to be able to map a quantum state of light into quantum state of matter and vice versa. So for creating a quantum network, we need to organize a light matter interface. We need to generate a non-classical state of light, and we need to learn how to map a quantum state of light onto state of matter. And what is memory? So we can consider some box, and we would like to store a photon with some quantum state inside this box. So we store this information, and then after some time, we can read out this information. And to perform quantum memory, we can consider a solid matter, and they're good because they have a large optical density, but they're bad because they have a very large decoherence at room temperature. And we also can consider atomic ensembles, and these atomic ensembles, they have a very long spin coherence time, so we can store information for a few microseconds. And they're bad because we are limited with optical depths, which is a product of density of atomic ensemble, wavelength of the atom in square, and the length of the atomic ensemble. So the main part of the quantum memory, it is light-matter interaction. But unfortunately, in free space, the interaction of a single photon with an atom is very weak. So if we consider atom and a photon with which it interacts, the resonant cross-section is proportional to lambda square. And we can find the absorption profile power or probability of interaction as a ratio of resonant cross-section and the diffraction zone, the area of diffraction zone. And you can see that this ratio is much less than one. So it means that in free space, the interaction of photon and atom is very weak. And we need to increase this interaction. And this we can do by putting an atom in a cavity. So here we'll increase the interaction because the atom will reflect from mirrors and pass the photon will reflect from mirrors and will pass atom a few times. Then we can consider atomic ensemble and increase number of atoms. In this case, the probability will be increased due to number of atoms. And we also can enhance the light matter interaction if we trap atoms near an waveguide. And in this case, we can increase the interaction due to a parsed factor. So, and in my talk, I will present you our results on quantum memory in free space. I will briefly tell you the idea of electromagnetically induced transparency and present our results on quantum memory for cesium in D2 line and for cesium in D1 line. And then I will tell you about our memory results in nanofiber configurations. Also present the memory based on EIT configuration and the DLCZ protocol. So what is EIT, the idea of electromagnetically induced transparency? For realization of the EIT, we need to consider an atom which has three levels. One is the ground state, and we prepare our atomic system that all atoms are in this ground state. Then we have excited state, and we have some additional state S. Then if we have a signal field, like a photon, which has a frequency close to G2E transition, the interaction can be described with absorption profile. But if we switch on the classical control field on the empty SE transition, we will open the transparency window close to the resonance with the excited state. And then if we will send the signal pulse inside this transparency window, it will propagate through the medium without absorption. And due to the dispersion profile, it will reduce group velocity. And this was the idea for slow light realization. And the first experiment was done in 1999 by Leni Hao, and she stopped light to 17 meters per second. And we also can switch off a control field at some moment. And with this, we can store light for some short period of time. And then a second switching on the control field allows us to read out this information. And so this we can describe schematically, that we have atomic ensemble. We have a control field on the MTSE transition. Then the probe field will propagate in the side of atomic ensemble. And when it starts to enter an ensemble, it squeezes. And when it's fully inside, one of the atoms will be transferred to S state due to the interaction between signal and control field. And then if we switch off the control field, we will have some atomic coherence, which is a super, and because we don't know which atom was transferred to a state, so it will be like a collective excitation and a superposition of all possible combinations between these two levels. And then if we switch on the control field again, also due to the interaction between control and signal field, the atom will be transferred back to the G state, and the photon will be propagate in forward direction with the same properties. And this is a photo of a magneto-optical trap. So this is a glass window, and with lasers from three sides, we can create a atomic cloud, which is quite dense and has cesium atoms inside. And in our experiment, we achieved, we worked with cesium in D2 line. So here I show you the atomic structure of cesium. And unfortunately, in D2 line, cesium has many hyperfine levels at the excited state. And initially, all atoms are populated, all Zeeman sublevels in its two levels of the ground state. And so we can prepare our atomic ensemble by switching on the repump laser from 4-to-4 transition. And this laser will allow us to transfer all atoms from ground state F equals 4 to ground state F equals 3. And F equals 3, it will be the ground state for us. Then we switch on the signal field resonant to 3-4 transition. And so in our experiment, we can achieve optical depths up to 300, which is very good. And then we implement the control field, which is resonant to 4-to-4 transition. So in this excitation scheme, all possible probe field will have a pair of the control field, and like this will not have losses due to absorption.
So Sasha, I see a question from Sandro Dubne.
Yes.
Let him ask. Yes, so forgive me, I'm not a specialist in the field, at least not in EIT. So it's a very naive question. So when you absorb light, do you absorb like one photon, one quantum, or do you absorb more than one photon in this kind of experiments?
I have only one photon. I cannot absorb more than one
okay,
photon.
Okay, so you absorb one photon, but you don't know at which transition exactly. So you
yes,
take into account
yes,
like
yes.
all of these transitions.
Yeah,
okay.
I take into and account. Yeah, ask.
Mm-hmm. And the information, like if we are talking about memory, is not say the polarization of this photon or where it is absorbed, is just the fact that like one photon is either there or it's not there. Or the information is the coherence between your ground state and your excited state. So
information is coherent. In experiment, I have, like, you know, we made a lot of times, same time, same type of the experiment, and then we average. It means that once it's possible that, okay, if we will use, I don't know, if we will use, if we'll absorb, it means that we will lose the photon, but another repetition of the experiment, we will have a photon. But it, when we will average, it means that we had one photon in the beginning, but then we will have 80% of the photon in the end. Right?
Mm-hmm. Maybe I'll try to formulate it better. So do you measure in experiment, the in this kind of experiments, the population of absorbed photons, say, or their phase also?
I think we measure, we don't work with the phase. We measure polarization. And we verify how much of this photon we can read out, like the efficiency part. So this I will tell a bit later.
Okay, thank you.
So we have our excitation scheme like this. We have a probe field, we have a control field, but because the control field is quite strong, we'll have some non-resonant interaction of the control field with another sublevels of the excited state. And this non-resonant interaction, which is shown with dashed lines, will lead to some losses in our system. And to describe the interaction of atomic system with light, we use standard optical block equations for density matrix. So here we have losses due to the finite lifetime of the excited state. So gamma it is the decay rate of the excited state of the atom, and H it is the Hamiltonian of the system, which has two parts. The first one it is a non-perturbative part, so it is a Hamiltonian of atomic system, field system, and also interaction, which we can describe as the interaction of atomic system with the electric field and also a possible magnetic field. And for electric field, we have two components. So we have a signal field or probe field and a control field. And here to describe the interaction of atomic system with a probe and control field, we use a dipole approximation. So our interaction is a product of a dipole moment on the amplitude of the field. But because we have many Zeeman sublevels and some polarization components, so we have sum over all Zeeman sublevels and over all excited state sublevels with which the field interacts. And to describe the response of atomic system, we use atomic susceptibility, which is proportional to the element of density matrix, which is responsible for the probe field interaction. So it is the element which corresponds to G to E transition for each Zeeman sublevels. And then we summarize because we have a linear configuration of our system. And as I told you that this interaction of the control field with all Zeeman sublevels will result in non-resonant, will result in some losses. And these losses can be described as an effective shift, which depends on the Rabi frequency of the control field, and also effective decoherence, which is also depends on the Rabi field of the control field, and it is also always positive. So it means that if you will increase optical depth, we will increase the Rabi frequency of the field, and we will increase the decoherence. But this decoherence will lead to reducing the transmission, which is crucial for EAT. So if from this picture, you can see that for a small optical depth, we can achieve the transmission, which is close to 100%, which is good. But if we have a very large optical depth, more than 300, we can transmit only half of the light, and another part will be absorbed. And also, like from these figures, you can see the shift. So it should be exactly at resonance. But with increasing optical depth and Rabi frequency, the shift is always also increasing. And to describe the light propagation, we need to solve a Maxwell equation. We can solve it in a Fourier transform. And the solution or output pulse can be found from inverse Fourier transform. And this solution depends on the susceptibility of the atomic ensemble. And we also introduce an important parameter for quantum memory. It is efficiency. And this efficiency is a ratio of the area over output pulse to its initial part. And in this plot, you can see the memory efficiency dependence on optical depth. With the green curve, I show the memory efficiency, which doesn't take into account the hyperfine structure. So, and here we can achieve almost 100% for high optical depths. But if we take into account the real structure of atomic ensemble, you can see that we can achieve a maximum efficiency close to 200, optical depths equal to 200. And then it will will reduce down.
So, and, Sasha, can I have a question?
Yes.
So, when speaking about optical depth, that does it quantify this potential which is created by laser beams, so in which the atoms are confined? So, do I understand correctly?
So, optical depth, it is a product of atomic density, mm-hmm. atomic wavelength in square, and the length of the atomic ensemble. Mm-hmm. So, it means that or you increase density or you increase number of atoms in your ensemble.
Oh, okay, okay.
So, you just collect more atoms together to have mm-hmm. this cloud.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks.
We made a quantum memory experiment for optical depth equal to 100. So here the transmission was around 80%. And we use atomic excitation, as I told you. And we fixed, the blue curve is our initial pulse. Then we switch on the control field, and this blue pulse start to reduce its group velocity, and then you have a slow down light. This is green, but if we switch off the control field, like here, for some period of time, and then switch on it again, we can read our pulse after this delay. So this is a red pulse, red curve. And in our experiment and calculation, we fixed a delay time. So this green pulse delayed compared with its initial pulse in two times of duration of this prop pulse. This ratio allows us to remove absorptions, losses due to leakage. So we don't have a light which start to go out from the atomic ensemble before the initial pulse enter. So this overlapping is very small for our case. And in this case, we can characterize the efficiency as with the formula which I showed you, that it is a ratio of the amplitude of the output pulse and the initial pulse. Otherwise, we need also to exclude this overlapping part. And in our experiment, for we achieved the maximum efficiency, which was 69% for 200. And you can see that our experimental results are very good agreement with theoretical calculations, where we took into account all hyperfine structure of atomic ensemble. And for creating this single photon state, we didn't create a single photon state. We use a coherent pulse with a average number of photon, which is 0.5, and we achieved memory storage time 1.5 microseconds. And then we made a characterization of the quantum state. So we wanted to verify how close the output photon compared to the input state. So for this, we use a fidelity, which can be found as a product of initial wave function to the output wave function. And for case, if we have absolutely opposite polarizations in input and output paths, the fidelity will be minimum, and it's 1/2. And then exists a classical benchmark which tell us about a quantum state. And to achieve this quantum state, this fidelity should be larger than 2/3 for a single photon limit. So if we put n equal to 1, you will get 2/3. And in our calculations, because we didn't use a single photon state, we use a coherent state, we took into account the Poisson distribution, And we got this blue curve to correct our fidelity to characterize it like a quantum state. And these red points, it is our experimental data. So it is fidelity depending on a mean photon number in our laser beam. And you can see that we are always above of the classical limit. So we have a quantum state. And we also, we can achieve the minimum 2/3 fidelity for average number 0.2, which was clearly achieved in our experiment because we have n equals 0.5. And also we verified the fidelity dependent on storage time. And with this fidelity, we can tell that we can we can store quantum state for up to 20 microseconds in our atomic ensemble. And then it was clear that if we consider not D2 line, but if we take a D1 line of cesium, here we will have only two levels in the excited state, and they will separate on over 1 gigahertz distance, and it will reduce our decoherence, and we can achieve a stronger, high memory efficiency. So we did this experiment again, and we keep the same delay time for our probe field. And in D1 configuration, we achieved 85% of the efficiency. And so here we didn't work with a photon. We already tried to store entanglement state, and it was more complicated experiment. And so you can read about this experiment in our last paper. And now I move to another experiment, which is based on nanofiber configurations. So, yes.
Sasha, before you move, may I ask very naive question regarding the previous part? So you were showing a spectrum, I think maybe even a couple of slides before, where there was a band gap with a peak in the middle. So band maybe gap. Even, I think, yeah, like this one, for the next one. Maybe the next one. Yeah, this one, for instance. It's a very, very naive question. I'm very sorry. So you have this band gap. Well, okay, the region from minus 20 to 20 mm-hmm. where transmission is low, and then there is a peak. So what determines the width of the peak?
It's radiation frequency of the contra field.
And the band gap is depends on density of atoms and stuff like this. Okay, thank you. Yeah.
Maybe I will ask another question regarding the first part. So you mentioned, Sasha, that you are using coherent light instead of, let's say, light with single photon statistics. Is it due to the limitations in intensity? So you need high intensities, and therefore the only option is some laser?
So we want to have one photon state. We have two possibilities. We can generate this single photon state, or we can use a coherent field with very low intensity just to have like approximately one photon. And then we can make this fidelity stuff to check if it was one photon or not. So this we did in this experiment. But then in a D1 line, we created a single photon in experiment. Then we made from this single photon entanglement state. So we changed the polarization, and we didn't know which polarization we had. And we store this entanglement state. So we separated our atomic ensembles on two to have to store two components. And then we read, and also we verify that we have same polarizations as we had for initial pulse. But so it just depends on, you make a simple experiment or you make a complicated experiment.
But essentially, still are working with single photons, but not, let's say, with entangled photon pairs or stuff like that. So it's essentially single photon experiment.
In G2, it was even not, it was a coherent light, but with an average number of photon to have approximately one photon.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay, so I move to second part. So we made also quantum memory in the presence of a nanofiber. So as I told you, we can increase the light-matter interaction if we trap atoms close to the nanofiber. So if we prepare or fabricate a fiber with a diameter which is less than atomic wavelengths, then the light cannot fully propagate inside the fiber and it will be evanescent field outside the fiber. And if we trap atoms in this region, it will increase the interaction between light which propagates in fiber and the atoms which are around. And so it comes from, so we can create, we can write the dispersion relations. And because the nanofiber has a refractive index from this ratio, we will have that longitudinal component is already more than omega over c. And it means that transverse component will be will have imaginary part. And the field which propagates in a transverse direction, it will be evanescent. And here I show you the dispersion for the fiber mode. So with the red one, it is a vacuum relation where omega c is equal to k. Then dashed line, it is a dispersion relation for dielectric, which corresponds to a fiber. And then for a single mode, the mode which propagates inside the fiber, the dispersion will be in the beginning, it will be close to the vacuum case, and then it will be changed close to the dielectric case. And such idea, such scheme was firstly proposed by Balikin and Hakuta. And now in experiment, there are many groups like in Germany, in France, in Japan, in Denmark, US, works in this direction. And so how we can define the size of the fiber to have a single mode propagation? So we can plot dispersion for plenty of modes which propagates in a normal fiber. And then we can see that if you will cut each layer, we can reduce number of modes. And then if we will cut here, we'll have we'll keep only one fundamental mode. And this can be achieved with conditions, which is written here. So the ratio between radius of the fiber and wavelengths, and also reflective indexes of fiber and in the vacuum should be less than 2.4. And for cesium, if you take into account the wavelengths of the cesium, the radius of the fiber should be less than 300. So in our experiment, we did we achieved the fibers with radius 200 nanometers. So we can fabricate this fiber in the lab. We have a flame and we can burn the cladding of the fiber. And we fabricate fibers with transmission 99% and with a diameter close to 400 nanometers. And this is like it looks in experiment. So we have a mode, magneto-optical trap, and inside of this mode we have a fiber, and this red part, it is a nanopart. And then when we start to cool atomic ensemble. So atoms are around everywhere inside this mode. And then when we start to cool atoms, we can trap them very close to the surface of this nanofiber. And in this picture, you can see just this nanofiber compared with the fiber, which was initially. So in here.
Sasha, I'm sorry for interruption. May I have a question on the previous slide, please?
Yes. Photo.
How can we see the red light? It's just because of some scattering. What kind of scattering?
Yes, it's some scattering. You just propagate, you send the laser there, but because it's really small.
The mode should be trapped, and we cannot see the trapped mode by the naked eye.
Mode is not trapped, but we send a laser, and then because it's very small part, the laser goes out. And because of scattering.
These are atoms. Are these atoms? Or?
Atoms are all around, so they are not trapped now.
Okay.
Some of them are close to surface, some of them are very far, but
by atoms?
Yeah, I guess because it's like I guess it's by atoms or dust or whatever else in the what we have in the mode.
Okay, thank you.
So here we first our experiment in this configuration was a AT experiment. So we had a cloud of atoms near the nanofiber, and we had a control field which was outside of the fiber. We also had a lambda configuration of our atomic ensemble. We prepared it in a ground state, and we switched on the control field, which was opposite transition. And here you can see the transmission. So if you don't have a control field, it is a blue curve. So the transmission in zero. Then we switch on the control field and we increase the Rabi frequency of this field. And we see that our transmission will have more and more better transparency window. So the green curve, then it will be a purple curve, and then it will be a yellow curve. So, and here we shift the transmission up to 75%. And then we made a slow light and a memory experiment for also different intensities of the control field. But here you can see that efficiency was very low, so we achieved only 10% of the efficiency. And so we estimated the reason of losses which would come. So this experiment was done before our free space experiment with all the Zeeman sublevels. So here was not optimal configuration of atomic ensembles. Also, there are losses, like not optimal intensity of the control field. And as a result, we got very low efficiency. And then we learned how we can trap atoms close to the surface. And also, additionally, it was a paper in 2001 by Duan, Lukin, Cirac, and Zoller, where they proposed how we can create a best scheme for implementation of quantum communications for long distances. And the idea of this approach was based on the consideration of ensemble of atoms. So we have atoms. We also prepare our, we have a three level configuration. We prepare our atomic system in its ground state. We apply a weak right pulse at GE transition, but it should be shifted from the resonance. And so we have atom which absorbs this field, then atom transferred to S state and emitted a field one in any direction. Then after some time, So we can write the state of which correspond of this interaction. So we have a large probability. So this field is weak. We have a large probability that we had a zero atom, which was transferred to S state, and as well zero photon in field one. And with a very low probability, we will have that one atom was transferred to S state and one photon was emitted in field one. Then, because we don't know which atom was exactly transferred, so we can write this atomic state as a superposition of all possible atoms. And so it will be some collective excitation which was stored. Then we switch on the strong read path, which is in opposite direction. This read path will result that atom will be sent back to ground state, and it will emit field two in opposite direction to field one. And then we can describe this state with a function psi 1 2. So here we will have already state with zero photon in field one and zero photon in field two, and with some probability that we'll have one photon in field one, and it will mean that we'll have one photon in field two, and then another component is a different number of photons.
So Sasha, sorry for interrupting. There is a question from Ivan Yorsh in the chat.
Yes.
So could you comment, please, why should we take the wave function as a coherent superposition of these two states?
Yeah. Probably I just so do I get it right that the transition between E and S is a spontaneous transition?
This is spontaneous emission. Yes,
it will be Stokes
like a component from Raman scattering.
So I don't have I just didn't quite get the first line. So you've got this square. So this is.
Tell me where.
Yeah, I just, so if the phase is arbitrary, so can we take a state as a coherent superposition of different states? In this case, I just probably missed something. So
yes, so state, the phase will be arbitrary, but to use this, We need this read pulse, which will be opposite. And this opposite read pulse will give us a field two with a direction which is completely opposite to field one. So we also use this phase matching here, and it is important.
Sasha, can you turn on even previous slide? Even, yeah. So Vanya and Sasha, do I understand right that from G to S you go? So it's with a field one, so it's not spontaneous.
Vanya. Yes. Yes.
So it's driven by this field one. Is this?
One moment. It's nothing driven. As far as I see at the picture, field one is, as I understand, is in some arbitrary direction.
Yes.
So this is a spontaneous just transition. Nothing is driven. Field one is just a.
No, but where? Okay, but where field one came from?
It's just frequent.
It's external field, right? So some kind of shine a light.
No.
That
was my question.
Vanya, why is it a problem for you if it's spontaneous emission? I understand that you want to say that phase is arbitrary. This is what I wanted to say, and phase is arbitrary. Your coherence is destroyed or whatever. But if there are no like real dephasing processes, I don't know, some movement of atoms, Doppler shift, something really dephasing, then I think it's still kind of, everything will be still coherent.
Well, that's like,
when for field one, you don't care about the direction. Then you should care about phase matching for field. Like write, read field one and field two.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, now you answered. Now I believe that I understood. So
it's why I tell that we have this read pulse, which is in opposite direction of the read pulse. And then we will have field 2, which is has opposite direction to field 1. Like this, we have this phase matching. But we need, when we detect, we need to find the direction of this field 1. Or we have, we have a detector, which has some angle. And then some events will be, we will lose them because we fixed, we want to have a field 2 in this direction. Or field 1 in this direction.
But still, sorry for being very stubborn. Field 1 came, it was a supporting beam, which was like came from a side or how?
It came from the pump which you have here.
Mm-hmm.
So you satisfy that it is, should be like one photon,
mm-hmm.
but then with difference in frequencies, you tell that it should be a frequency of E to S transition, mm-hmm. and then you don't care about direction. Direction you care for field 2, it should be with a matching of all k vectors of these four fields.
Okay. It came from vacuum fluctuations.
Yeah.
So you transfer, and then we play this DLCZ protocol in our nanofiber configurations. So we had a write and read pulse which were outside of the fiber to don't have problems with chirality and complex configuration of the polarization inside the nanofiber. And we made this phase matching to have a field 1 and field 2 inside the fiber. And like this, quantum field was integrated in our setup. So here is the excitation scheme. As I told you that right pulse was Y polarization to have a field 2, which is also in white polarization. It is not chiral. So it was very nice to study chirality in this experiment as well. So, and then we characterize these non-classical correlations between field 1 and field 2. So this is a ratio of probability to detect a pair of photons in field 1 and field 2, and to the product of probabilities of photon in field 1 and a photon in field 2. So here is dependence of this G12 correlations to the excitation probability. And so for classical state, G12 should be equal to, we are above of this. For our configuration, we got G12 close to 100. It was a record for a G12 function. For G12 function, which is more than 7, we can check Bell violation and work with this Bell inequality in experiment. And also, like according to Duan, Lukin, Zoller, and Cirac, G12 more than 25, it is enough to create quantum repeaters and make quantum communications for long distance. And we also characterize our
Sasha,
yes.
I'm not sure, probably it's out of the scope, but could you very briefly explain what is a quantum repeater?
What is quantum repeater? So quantum repeater, I will come back.
It's like classical with quantum.
Thanks, Michel. You're so smart. So we want to transfer the light or information for the long distance, but the losses, if you transfer it in a channel, it would be have a, like exponential dependence with the distance. It means that if you want to transfer for a larger distance, you will transfer very small part of the information. And then it was proposed to split for this channel for small channels, for small distance, and for each side of this channel to have a quantum memory with a quantum repeater. And in this quantum repeater, you will have entanglement state and making the Bell Bell measurement, you will, in using this entanglement state, you will transfer the information from one node to another one.
So this has no connection with this no cloning theorem. So you don't actually produce a copy of your quantum state.
No, you don't produce. You transfer, like, what was this? What was the word, another one? Not cloning, but you.
You can say Russian.
You have what?
You can say it in Russian if you don't.
I don't remember. It's same word in Russian as in English.
Well, probably in French. Mm-hmm. Sat knows French as I know. Mm-hmm. No, okay. Because here in ITMO we also built a quantum internet, but I always curious what is it somehow related to this no cloning problem. So
no, it is not related. Like in non cloning, you just cannot make a copy, but then when you want to I don't know how you kill in one side and then you transfer in another one. It's not copy, but you transfer it. Teleportation. What is this part?
Entanglement.
Teleportation. You just teleport your state from one place to another one, but you do this by using entanglement state. So in applying a Bell measurement for this entanglement state and the state which you send. Like you do this Bell measurement, you kill your state which you have, but then you send a copy to another part of this entanglement state.
Okay.
May I ask a very maybe general question? I don't know if it's totally relevant to all these quantum operations with ensembles of atoms. So, namely, I could think that you have, say, classical systems, which have many, many, many levels, and you have qubits, which have only two levels. Now, what you have in all these experiments, you have a lot of atoms. Mm-hmm. All of them are supposedly quantum, each atom is as quantum as it gets, but you have really a lot of them, so thousands, or I don't know, and maybe you even don't know how many atoms do you have. So isn't it, you know how many photons you have, but you don't know how many atoms you have. Isn't it a problem for at least some experiments that actually the system you are working with to process signals is not a single qubit or not five qubits, but is a huge array? Isn't it a problem?
Sorry, what, you want to have more photons?
Well, I want to have less atoms. I am not sure. I don't argue with these experiments, and also I understand that you excite some specific symmetric superposition of atoms.
So for this atoms, but we prepare them in the same configuration. They are all identical.
Yeah. So it's never a problem, yes. Right?
Yes.
So you could have as many atoms, because something for me, I don't argue that these experiments are correct, certainly, and I understand why everything works. But still, I have a feeling that since you have such a large ensemble of atoms, at some moment it should start to behave as a classical system, and then something should fail. But maybe it's an entirely wrong idea.
Or for instance, two atoms can absorb single photons, so there could be some collective phenomena.
So in this configuration, the distance between atoms is very large. So we don't have a dipole-dipole interaction.
Mm-hmm.
And it is not like your atom absorbs a photon, then it emits, but like the way of the emitted photon is much larger than atomic wavelengths. So another atom will not see it, and it will consider it like a photon which comes from whatever. So it will not have problems of atom-atom interaction to simplify, to make this interaction more complex.
So do I get right that actually if you have many atoms in a single state, it's quite the same that you have like a Bose condensate which is described by a single wave function, and then you don't really care how many atoms.
Yes.
You really cannot know how many atoms you...
Yes, you I don't care. But actually in nanofiber, it's different. So in nanofiber, you will have atom-atom interaction in any case. And of course, it is a problem. And it's why here we like put this write and read pulse externally to don't have problems or effect of this atom-atom interaction.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
So like in free space, all atoms are identical, they don't interact and you don't care. And you use like single atom description and then just multiply on number of atoms. But then in nanofiber, you artificially, like you want to increase this interaction and you increase it just because of also atom-atom interaction. And then of course it will affect your interaction process and make everything more complex. And then here, of course, it's better to have less atoms to describe all the system and reduce many losses which come from this.
So there is some trade-off, right? If you have just one atom, the interaction with light is very weak, but if you have many, many atoms close together, they somehow stop becoming a good quantum system. So there is some optimum.
Yeah, you can tell like this, that you can enhance your properties of quantum state, or you can make losses. Then you just need to be more careful what you want to get, and to clean a system to make a better physics with this. But like you just need to understand how it will work with 2,000 atoms, and how these 2,000 atoms will help you, or how they can make everything worse, and you try to avoid this. Losses which it will bring the interaction, right?
Thank you.
So we also analyze the memory. So we plot the efficiency of memory depending on the excitation probability. And here you can see that we have three regions. So in the up part of the plot, we will have a multi-photon regime where the probability to have more than one photon is high. So this is not a single photon state. Then in the middle, in the plateau, we have a single excitation regime. And here we achieved the efficiency close to 25%. And then the third part, it is a low excitation regime. And here you'll have some force event, which corresponds that we will have a photon in field two, but without a photon in field one or something like this. So, and in this configuration, we achieve a storage time 200 nanoseconds. And we also analyze this storage time. Efficiency on its storage time, and here it for some losses which will bring the exponential dependence. And we analyze the suppression of two photon component, like a probability or verification that we have a single photon in field two. So it is a function V, which depends on the cross correlation function G12. And here, so as you remember, we achieved G12 close to 100. And it means that for this very high G12, the suppression will be 0.1, which will give a good probability that we have a single photon state in field 2. And then we also plot the shape of the field 2 and show that it has a Lorentzian or Gaussian shape, which correspond to the initial shape of the right field. So in this experiment, we achieved the heralding, storing, and leading out of the single atomic state, which was coupled to a nanoscale waveguide. And we confirmed that we have a single photon character of this state. So, and to conclude, I would repeat that we found the optimal interaction configuration for cesium atoms, which will correspond to the minimum losses and the maximum of efficiency. We demonstrated that considering G1 line will improve memory efficiency. We obtain efficiency 69 for G2 line and 85 for G1 line. And it is the highest efficiency for this atomic configuration and which was achieved today. Then we also demonstrated that nanofiber configuration allows to achieve a stronger light matter interface. And we generated heralded collective single excitation at a hybrid system of trapped atoms in the vicinity of optical nanofiber. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Sasha, for the nice talk. So we have some time for questions. If there are any, please colleagues raise your hands. So in the meantime, I will ask the first one. So you mentioned that you achieve storage times up to 20 microseconds. So can you tell us what is the general quest? So is it already good or it's not enough to perform some operations with this quantum information, let's say?
So usually this memory time is limited by lifetime of excited state. Mm-hmm. So for cesium, it is a few nanoseconds. Mm-hmm. So if you have one atom, you will not get more than its lifetime.
Yeah.
Then we have this ensemble of atoms and we can increase this memory time. So of course, it's important for quantum communication when you will wait when a photon will come to make this Bell measurement and synthesis. And microseconds is still very small. Nanoseconds is small. Microseconds is already not so bad, but it is what we can get with atomic ensembles.
Mm-hmm. Good, thank you. Some other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. So.
Yeah.
So does this quality of this operation somehow depends on the number of atoms actually, like?
Of which operation?
The value of efficiency, which was like 100, can you increase it by increasing the number of atoms or no? So how many atoms do you actually need? Probably I missed this.
So initially, as I told, it was predicted that if you have a lot of atoms, you can achieve high efficiency. So this curve, this green curve, it exactly uh-huh. telling this. So if you get a lot of atoms, you get high optical depth and you can achieve memory efficiency. But then if you will work with real atoms, you will have some limitations. So with D1 line, it would be much better. You can get this high efficiency. What limits?
But the same holds for the second part of the talk as well, right? So
they actually, the loss is scaled like 1 minus 1 over OD, something like this. So if you have high optical depths, you will reduce these losses and you will have a high efficiency.
I see.
Then what? what you started to.
Thanks.
And then the next question about the theory. So it looks like the theory is written for zero temperature, but then what are the restrictions on the temperature of atoms?
So we cool down our atoms. So we have a few macrocadian, I guess. Mm-hmm. But we also made a theory. We took into account, we also did hot atoms. Mm-hmm. We took into account like Doppler broadening, which bring some temperature effect. And I guess so here, this is also dashed line. So the solid line, it is zero temperature. Then for dashed, we took this not zero, but very small temperature. Mm-hmm. And Doppler broadening, which comes from this, and you can see that it's not so big difference. So temperature is not a big deal here. So temperature is bad for memory time, for sure, mm-hmm. but not for efficiency.
Okay, good, thank you. So some other questions, some comments?
I wonder, atoms are in some trap, right? At least in one of them, these
yes.
experiments. So are there any like vibrational levels in this trap, and what is the vibration frequency compared to experiment, to the frequencies you scales in experiment?
So we thought about this. We tried to find if we can have like molecules cesium 2 in these ensembles. Have this vibration levels, but actually not so big effect of this.
Why do we need cesium? Just
because cesium has one electron in the external state, so it can be cesium, it can be rubidium. We work with cesium.
Mm-hmm.
It's more heavier and it's better for memory and for like it's heavy and it allows to get better. A slowdown of group velocity. But you can use rubidium, you can use strontium, you can use any elements of first group.
Yeah, but if you get light elements, you'll have this trap frequencies higher, right?
Yeah, they will be different. Then you will have a different, this velocity, the group velocity will be a bit different,
mm-hmm.
but the physics will be the same. Just will need another numbers for your intensity of field and synergies. But
okay, so I guess that's all. Thank you so much, Sasha, for the nice talk. So next time in a week, we will have a seminar by Mario Silverini, Quantum Light Matter Interactions in Non-Reciprocal Platforms. So please stay with us, join us next time. And thank you, Sasha, once again.
Thank you for the invitation.
Yeah, goodbye. See you.
Bye.